Today, we will be discussing feedback in systems or feedback systems. It is one of the most important topics in signal processing. We will see this presently. In the previous lecture, we had seen applications of multipliers, comparators and macro models of BJTs and FETs. Realization of voltage buffer, current buffer, transconductance amplifier and transresistance amplifiers using nullator-norator concept and then corresponding equivalent models of the transistors and replacing these nullator narrators with transistor has been done to achieve these near ideal amplifiers. Voltage buffer means unity gain voltage amplifier, current buffer means unity gain current amplifier, transconductance amplifier and transresistance amplifier with specific transconductance and transresistance, all realized using BJT or FET. The topologies of these may be looking like, for example, using MOSFET this is the MOSFET and this was voltage follower. This being a nullator for the MOSFET, Vi was completely appearing as Vi at the output. And then as a current buffer, it was looking like this, common gate, this is common collector it was called, common gate. So, this was the nullator coming in shunt and therefore it was whatever current was inputted, okay, was going into the other side. That means this source current is same as drain current, okay. There is no current flow in this. This is a nullator. So, the voltage was 0. So, it was appearing as a short at the input. And this current I naught equals II current buffer. You could put any load here. Similarly, you could put any load here. So, and this is a voltage controlled voltage source with unity gain, current controlled current source with unity gain, and then we discussed the other two topologies. G, so Vi was applied here, G times Vi was appearing here. So, a transconductance amplifier and then a transresistance amplifier. So, these were the stages that we had understood in the last class. Now, you will see that these are also actually considered as feedback structures. These are all feedback structures. So, we have synthesized this feedback structure, not discussing feedback at all, but using the concept of nullator and narrator. And then today we are going to learn more about system level concepts of feedback. A dynamic system with feedback is what we are going to discuss today. We have Xi as input, and it is having a summing stage where these two variables xi and feedback parameter xf get added. So this is a summer where we have the output equal to xi plus xf at this point. So this is the feedback parameter, this is the input parameter. This is what is called a gain block, or this is a block which transfers the input to some form of output, right, and the relationship is governed by g1. Okay. So in a linear system, this is simply multiplying its input by g1 and appearing as output. So again, the output here is fed back through this block, that is why this is called the feedback path, this is the forward path, and g2 is the parameter relating input to output in the feedback path. So xf is equal to x0 into g2. So this now becomes x0 equals xi plus xf into g1. Okay. Xf itself is x0 into g2 as shown here, that into g1. So from this we can get x0 coefficient as x0 into 1 minus g1 g2 equals xi into g1, which gives us x0 by xi, a relationship between output and input of this system, as g1 by 1 minus g1 g2. This is an important relationship. Okay, and xf is the feedback parameter, x0 is the output parameter, xcs is the error. Okay, so we will see this, that if g2 is negative, it is called negative feedback. Okay, so that this sign, when it is coming here as minus and getting added, then it is coming as xi minus this factor, or g2 is negative, this is negative feedback, and g2 is positive, it is positive feedback if g1 is positive, or g1 into g2 should be negative for negative feedback. G1 into g2 is called the loop gain, of the system. So g1 into g2 equal to the loop gain. If this loop gain is negative, it is called negative feedback. If the loop gain is positive, it is called positive feedback. So these are the set of equations which we have already derived. Xf by xi becomes g1 g2 by 1 minus g1 g2. Xcs is xi by 1 minus g1 g2. Gf is x0 by xi, it is g1 by 1 minus g1 g2. Or minus 1 by g2 divided by 1 minus 1 by g1 g2. So this is an important concept, that xi and xf are related by this. Xcs is xi divided by 1 minus g1 g2. So if g1 g2 is negative, let us say g1 g2 is equal to minus some positive number, it is going to be only a number, dimensionless quantity. So this is going to be xi by 1 plus n. When n is very large, this, okay, error, this is then called error because it's going to appear as xi minus, okay, this factor, okay, even though you are summing it, because of g2 being negative, you can therefore see that this is the error, it computes the error. So the error goes to 0 in a system, or this one xf divided by xi, okay, becomes minus n by 1 plus n, or this becomes minus 1. So if this is minus, okay, then it is negative feedback, and therefore output, okay, xf, okay, here the feedback output portion of output is going to be following input in magnitude, and if it is summing thing, it is of opposite phase, that, okay, the sign inversion is going to be there. If this is instead of plus a differentiating thing, then this is going to be just 1, okay. So please make a note of this, conventional control system feedback, okay, always shows this summer as a differentiating thing. So this minus sign of the negative feedback is automatically taken into consideration. So output, this xf feedback thing follows the input, okay, whereas in this, if it is a summer, xi is going to be making xf follow it in magnitude but opposite in sign, so that the error always gets computed here, and error goes to 0. Or the system has this concept that we have already introduced to you, okay, earlier. So it is just that it is coming now again, right. So this becomes a negative feedback system where xf follows xi in magnitude, and if it is summer, it is minus. If it is a differentiating component, it is exactly following in magnitude and sign, okay. So this is what is explained in the this thing. GL has to be negative. If magnitude of loop gain is much greater than 1, then x naught by xi, okay, is minus 1 by g2, okay. That means it is insensitive to g1, it is independent of g1, okay, and xf by xi is equal to minus 1, that is what we had shown earlier, and xcs goes to 0, or actually it becomes a nullator at the input. So whatever variable we have considered as inputting g1, okay, that itself goes to 0. That is the primary thing about negative feedback. What is the consequence of that? Because of xcs going to 0, xf, okay, is going to be minus xi, so that the summer actually has at its output the error, okay, and x naught by xi, which is independent of, okay, g1, and minus 1 by g2 is the value. G2 in the feedback results in the forward transmission from output input becoming 1 over g2. This is the inversion property. This is another important conclusion. So if g2 is the forward function of the feedback block, when we put it in the feedback, the forward transfer parameter of the system becomes 1 over g2. This is the inversion. This is following action, follower action. Output follows the input in magnitude, and nullator at the input. These are the three important conclusions that we can arrive at, and the application of almost all feedback systems today is lying in these three basic concepts being followed. So let us consider a positive feedback system. A positive feedback system, on the other hand, has GL positive, okay, and let us say it lies between 1 over G1, G2 lies between 0 and 1, then X0 by Xi becomes highly sensitive. This is the to the variations in loop gain or the variation in G1 causing variation in loop gain. Whereas in the earlier case, X0 by Xi was independent of G1, it is insensitive. Whereas in this case, X0 by Xi becomes highly sensitive to variations in GL. So this kind of feedback is never to be used, okay, in our linear system design, okay. And we, if this G1 into G2 or the loop gain is positive, and then if loop gain is positive, it is a positive feedback, and it is greater than or equal to 1, then it is regenerative feedback. What does it mean? Then output is just going to infinity. At GL equal to 1, it already goes to infinity, that is unstable. There is no finite relationship between output and input. Output just happily goes independent of input, okay, to infinity. Infinity means positive saturation or negative saturation, okay. So that is the limit of practical output possible. So in the case of amplifiers and all, it is the supply voltage. So when GL is positive and 1 over GL is greater than or equal to 1, that system cannot be discussed further in terms of equations. Its output is going to be either high or low. So it is an interface component at that point of time. This amplifier is working as a comparator, and it is giving a digital indication of, okay, what the state of input is. Is it greater than some value or less than some value? Okay. So X0 by Xi going to infinity, a practical dynamic system goes into saturation, where the gain is 0. There is no relationship between output and input which is linear any longer. So sensitivity in negative feedback, we are going to emphasize this in terms of equations. So this is an important parameter to be defined for understanding the advantage of negative feedback. So let us define sensitivity. Sensitivity of GF with feedback, gain with feedback, for G1, sensitivity of the response to changes in G1 is defined mathematically as change in GF divided by GF, change in G1, okay, for change in GF cause for a change in G1, this is the nominal value of G1 at which this happens. So delta GF by GF divided by delta G by G, delta G1 by G1. So the percentage change in GF due to percentage change in G1. So that is mathematically you can derive that, because we know the relationship between GF and G1 as it is G1 by 1 minus G1 G2. So you simply differentiate it, GF, this is GF. So you just delta GF by delta G1, okay, you find out. and then multiply by G1 divided by Gf. You can show that it is equal to 1 by 1 minus G1 G2. So, if G1 G2 is negative, like we just said, let G1 G2 be minus n. So, this is 1 by 1 plus n. As n goes to infinity, this tends to 0. That means it becomes insensitive. Okay. Sensitivity in negative feedback systems. If you now find out the sensitivity of Gf to G2, obviously it just depends only on G2. So, that is established here very clearly by again differentiating this Gf delta Gf by delta G2 multiplying by G2 by Df, then it becomes minus 1. It is directly dependent upon G2 alone. Any variation in G2 causes, okay, any variation in G2 causes inverse variation in Gf. Okay. That means actually it is demonstrating the inverting property of the feedback system also. The sensitivity is inversely proportional to G2. Now, that is demonstrated in practice by designing a voltage amplifier with a gain of 10, for example. So, you can see that this is G1 block, it is a differential amplifier. So, we have Vi here and V0 into the attenuation here. So, that is actually we can now say that one by 10 attenuation, 1k and 9k. So, 1 by 1 plus 9 is 1 by 10 with a negative sign because you are summing it up with an inversion. So, what you get here is a negative feedback system because G1 into G2 is going to be G1 into minus 1 by 10. This is G1 into G2. So, if this is much greater than, okay, if this G1 into G2 magnitude, okay, is much greater than 1, then we get this fact that V0 over Vi is going to be one over this minus one over G2, that is just 10. So, this is demonstrated by this, that is going to be demonstrated by changing G1 from let us say 1000 to 100 and showing that output remains, okay, same for a given input. So, this error goes to 0, this becomes a nullator. That we have demonstrated earlier also, right. So, now inversion property is demonstrated, 1 over 10 put in the feedback path makes it become an amplifier with gain 10, voltage amplifier with gain 10, attenuator in the feedback path. And it is insensitive to G1, that is demonstrated by changing G1. For example, let us first take G1 as 1000, then the gain becomes 9.9, 10 by 1 plus 1 over 1000 into 1 by 10. So, that is 9.9. So, we have sensitivity of Gf to G1 as 1 by 11. Okay. For G1 equal to 100 and G2 equal to minus 1 over 10, Gf is 9.09. It is still very close to 10, right, but deviating slightly because the loop gain is reduced by a factor of 10. The loop gain is reduced by a factor of 10. Okay. Even so, the feedback amplifier gain is remaining pretty close to the design value of 10. This is demonstrating the insensitivity. So, voltage amplifier is simulated with G1 equal to 1000 and G2 equal to minus 1 over 10, G1 equal to 100 and G2 equal to minus 1 over 10 again. And you do not find any difference. This is the input and that is the output. It remains almost the same except for a small reduction when the loop gain is lower. Sensitivity and negative feedback is again demonstrated by designing a current amplifier. So, this is a current amplifier using the same op amp here, okay. And you can see that the 9k and 1k form the current division here. This current is divided between this 9k and 1k. So, the current going into this feedback is going to be 1 by 1 plus 9, which is 1/10 again. So, x naught is the current now, that x naught by 10 is fed back, and current feedback occurs at a single node, whereas voltage feedback occurs between two nodes, okay. So, using a single node we can feed back current. So, this input current now is xi minus x naught by 10, so the error current, and when g this gain current, I mean this is a transconductance or this is an amplifier, let us say g, when it goes to infinity, then this whole system behaves as a current amplifier with gain equal to 10. So, you can see this load is coming in series with whatever current that is flowing. So, gain becomes 9.52 if G1 is 200, for example, we have taken a different value of G1, G2 is equal to minus 1 over 10 in this case, that remains the same. So, and it is nearly 10, okay, it is 9.52 now. Sensitivity is 1 by 21. And we have designed the current amplifier for different gains. Earlier it was 250, now 1100, variation is very little. You can see this is the input current, that is the output current, and these do not remain, these remain the same, right, almost literally no difference exists between this and this. So, before we sort of close this, we can just say that using a transistor, for example, the current amplifier same thing, this is the active device, this is the op amp, okay. The current gain is nearly infinity here, input current and output current. So, I give the full output feedback here. So, this is II and I naught is going to be equal to II, if this GM of this transconductor, this is nothing but a transconductor, it is going towards infinity. That means, even in a MOSFET, this becomes a current follower. This automatically, if you put the load here, right, even then this is valid, so arbitrary load. So, this current feedback remains the same, okay. And therefore, output current follows the input current. This is a current follower or a current buffer with gain equal to minus 1, and this is same as the common gate topology which we have synthesized earlier. So, this is common between input and output, the gate. So, it is a feedback topology that we have discussed that can be even designed using a diode. This is called MOSFET connected as a diode if RL is 0. Similarly, the bipolar transistor circuit will look the same. In the current feedback, this II is very nearly equal to I naught, but opposite in sign. So, if RL is 0, it is become looking like a diode connected transistor, both of them. So that is a feedback topology. Okay. Now we come to the other important application, but using instead of a linear block in the feedback, okay, we are using a non-linear block. What is it? We are using a multiplier. Okay, Vc has to be kept positive to ensure. Okay, loop gain. So now we have the same G1 here. This is my G1 block, and G2 block is nothing but, okay, sort of minus, okay, Vc, okay, V0 by 10. So as long as Vc is positive, this is negative feedback. If Vc is negative, it becomes positive feedback. So you have to be careful here. So for this to work in negative feedback mode, Vc has to be positive. That is important. If you do that, ultimately we get this important relationship. Vi is always going to be equal to V0, and this is Vc by 10, or V0 is 10 Vi by Vc. So it becomes an inverse function. What is it? If it is a multiplier in the feedback path, output when I take and put it in this feedback path multiplier, it becomes V0 over Vi becomes a dividing action, 10 Vi by Vc. Vc is multiplying this voltage V0, whereas here it is coming as 10 into Vi by Vc. So it is a divider. So this illustrates the property of inversion that is possible. If you have a block that is doing some function, you can always get the inverse of the function, okay, if you put it in the feedback path. That is illustrated here. We have got the attenuator converting it to an amplifier. We have a multiplier converting it to a divider, okay. And now we will see a squarer put in the feedback path will make it obviously a square root. So this is V0 and it is connected to both the inputs of the multiplier. So the output of the multiplier is V0 squared by 10. So Vi becomes equal to V0 squared by 10. This error voltage goes to 0, nullator. So V0 is equal to root of 10 times Vi. So we have got this square rooting operation performed, okay, without any problem. Square rooting, because V0 squared by 10 is equal to Vi, from which we get V0 as square root of 10 times Vi. So now you can actually now put the multiplier with this as Vp sin omega t, okay, and this as Vc. So the output of the multiplier is going to be Vc Vpi sin omega t. So it is going to be, let us see, Vc Vpi by 10 sin omega t. This is the output. So now this is the VPO. So it is squared here. So VPO squared by 10, okay, because this is VPO sin omega t. So VPO squared by 10 into sin squared omega t is what appears here, which gives you DC. If you put a low pass filter, the voltage here will be VPO squared by 20, because sin squared omega t is 1 minus cos 2 omega t by 2. 10. So that will be 20. So you have a DC voltage here, and this is got rid of by the low pass filter. So we have here a DC voltage of VPO squared by 20 becoming equal to V reference. So that is what is demonstrated here. So V reference is equal to VPO squared by 20, or VPO equal to square root of 20 into V reference. So it remains constant. This VPO, the peak value of output voltage here at the output of the multiplier, remains constant at square root of 20 times V reference. So it is a square rooting thing, because we have put a squaring thing, okay, in the feedback path, but it is done for an AC voltage, right. So that means this is converting AC to DC here. This is AC to DC converter, okay, and this is DC to AC converter here. AC to DC converter here, this is DC to AC converter here, right. So that amplitude is going to remain constant at square root of 20 into V reference. This is an important concept that we must indicate, okay, here. So if I keep on changing this, it is of no consequence in the feedback, okay. This will always make it, make this one appear as equal to this, okay. That means output amplitude of this DC is remaining constant at V reference. Consequently, VPO of this remains constant at square root of 20 into V reference. That means this whole system now becomes an AGC system, automatic gain control system, okay, AGC or AVC or an AC regulator. So if this line voltage keeps on changing here, fluctuating here, it is of no consequence. This loop will make sure that the output voltage remains constant at square root of 20 into V reference sin omega t. So this is an important signal processing concept. This is the front end of most of our RF systems, IF systems, okay, where the receive signal, antenna signal keeps on changing, okay. However, inside the receiver system, we have a means of controlling this output amplitude to remain fairly constant, okay, and that is necessary input stage or a front end of all receivers today, television, radio, as well as your cell phones. All these contain this kind of AGC system in order to maintain the received signal amplitude, okay, of RF, okay, remain at a fairly decent level, constant, okay. And this kind of system everybody should know how to build. So it is also an important concept to be used in AC regulators in power supplies, right. The 50 hertz power supply, if it clips on fluctuating in the line, it can be maintained constant using a similar feedback set, automatic AC voltage regulator. Here it is a DC voltage regulator always. So for this, okay, this is a DC voltage regulator at this point, and it is automatically becoming an AC voltage regulator at this point because of the feedback. So inversion property and also its use in AC regulator and DC regulator is demonstrated in the negative feedback. This will be discussed in detail further, okay. So this is simulated is AGC scheme. There is a minor difference. Instead of comparing it with this voltage, I can also convert this this way, that I can ground this and connect a resistance here and apply the same resistance and inversion of this, then it becomes a current comparator. This we have discussed earlier. Okay, you can ground this and convert it into a current by using the same resistor, okay, and filter it using the capacitor. And capacitor can be put across this, okay, to increase the effect of this. We'll show later that if you put a capacitor between output and input of an amplifier, 8 times that value of capacitor gets simulated at the input. So instead of using a capacitor to ground, you can put a lower capacitor between output and input and see a much larger capacitor at the input. Okay, this will demonstrate later. However, even if you put a large capacitor across this, same effect is same. Okay, so this is the modification that we can do. This can be grounded and this can be connected to minus V reference. The same equation gets valid. So that is what is simulated in the next circuit. So you see, I have maintained V reference equal to 0.8. So VPO becomes square root of 0.8 into 20. So that is 16, which is 4. Square root of 16 is 4. So output amplitude of this multiplier is maintained at 4 volts irrespective of the input amplitude. Input amplitude have changed from 10 to 8, okay, to 5 and then 4. Okay. So the output amplitude remains constant at 4 at all points of time. So this is the beauty of this control system, which is called AGC or AVC. Now another application of this negative feedback and inversion is true RMS generator. You can square using multiplier and average using low pass filter, and then you can put the squarer in the feedback path and get a square rooting action here. This is the square rooting action. So this is a squarer. Okay, this is a square rooter. So this, if you now apply a periodic waveform of any shape, okay, this signal processing block straight away determines this true RMS value of the waveform, which is an important measure in most of our electronics applications. True RMS indicator. Now we come to an important point which we have already discussed, that we have a feedback system with G1 and G2 forming a loop. Okay, and we are now going to discuss what happens to XF, okay, and XI and X0 in this feedback system, which is a special feedback system. Okay, this we will call it as encoder decoder feedback system. Feedback system with G1 as encoder, G2 is a decoder. That means it has input and output variables interchanged. Input of one becomes output of the other, output of the other one becomes input of this first one. So G1 is called an encoder, G2 is called a decoder. So output parameter need not be the same as input parameter, that is the difference. So these perform a large number of communication functions. Encoding and decoding is, depending upon the channel, is the characteristic feature of most of the communication channels and signal processing functions needed in communication. So for example, right, if you whatever happens here is that inverse function is related obtained as output, okay, and follower function is obtained at the input. Okay. So let us consider the examples of this current to voltage converter and voltage to current converter. These are the two encoder and decoder combinations here, trans resistance amplifier and transconductance amplifier. So, the parameter at this input is current, parameter at this point is voltage. So, you can give current as feedback. Okay. So, you call this output current and this is input current. Output current always follows input current. So, this is a current follower. The same loop, if you put this here and this one here, okay, that is what it is, transconductance amplifier here, transistor becomes a voltage follower. See the difference? So, this is a current follower where it takes the error current here as the input, okay, error, and output here is voltage, okay, and it is a current to voltage converter with G2 coming into picture as the transfer parameter. Okay, this is Gm, that is 1 over Gm is the inversion factor here. So, Gm is the forward that is feedback factor. So, 1 over Gm is the forward gain of this stage, which is V0 by Vi. So, by putting a transconductor in the feedback part of an amplifier, we are realizing a trans resistor amplifier. Gm into Rf is the loop gain, it has to be much greater than 1 in this case. The same loop with this point as input and the loop continued here is going to be acting as a voltage follower. So, this is the advantage of encoder decoder combination. Both voltage follower action and current follower action can be done by the same loop with the same loop gain Gm into Rf. Once it is much greater than 1, it can either act as a voltage to current converter or voltage follower or current follower and current to voltage converter. AC to DC converter and DC to AC converter, AC voltage follower here, or the other way about, this AC voltage follower, and if you give the input at this point, it is a DC voltage follower. This is the beauty of the thing. So, voltage DC can be converted to AC with a certain factor, which is 1 over G2 again, right? Or you can have that AC can be converted to DC by putting DC to AC in the feedback path. Okay. This we have already demonstrated as a AGC scheme, where we have maintained the DC input to this whole system error constant, okay, and it becomes a AC voltage follower. Okay. So, it is a AC voltage follower or a DC voltage follower, right. And then AGC scheme adopts this kind of DC voltage follower being adopted as AC voltage follower. So, if you maintain this DC constant, this DC will be constant and therefore this AC will be constant. Okay, it will be related to this by this factor, transfer parameter. Okay. Same thing can be done with phase followers. Phi I is the input, phi naught is the output. You have a phase to voltage converter and voltage to phase converter here. So, this fourth phase follower it becomes at this input, and if you use the same loop with voltage as the input, it becomes a voltage follower. This is the voltage follower. That means, if you maintain voltage constant, the phase will be constant here. Okay. So, if you may change this voltage, the phase will change accordingly. So, it can be used for phase modulation, okay, direct phase modulation. Next, finally, if you have a V to F converter here and F to V converter here, F2V converter is a phase detector that we have already seen in multiplier application. V2F converter is nothing but a VCO, it is a voltage follower. So, if voltage is maintained constant, the frequency will be maintained constant, and if you have frequency as input here, voltage becomes output here. It can be converted from frequency to voltage here, and the conversion factor is inverse of this, which is voltage to frequency converter, which is a VCO, right. So, this is an important thing that we have to understand. This is the VCO, voltage to frequency converter. This is called a phase detector. So, the phase difference is converted into a DC voltage, that is by using a multiplier and a low pass filter here. So, multiplier and a low pass filter here with the VCO gives what you commonly call as frequency lock loop. So, if this frequency changes, this changes accordingly, right. So, this is the advantage of this concept, and that is done in frequency lock loop here. We have a VCO which can be nothing but an FM generator. So, if you apply a DC here, you get a fixed frequency here. If this DC changes, this frequency changes proportionately. So, if it is a linear VCO as demonstrated here, it is a linear VCO. 10,000 hertz is the quiescent frequency plus k times Vc, okay. So, that is what is done here, k times Vc. So, this output frequency is directly proportional to the control voltage here. So, this is a multiplier with low pass filter forming a phase detector. We have demonstrated the ability of this phase detector earlier. It can be a linear phase detector if these two are square waves. So, this is called the sensitivity of the VCO k, 1000 hertz per VC, right. So, what happens if this frequency is same as this frequency, then we have seen that this is Vp sin omega t. Let us say this is Vp sin omega t plus phi, then this will be Vp Vp dash cos phi. So, if it is not to change, okay, from a value which is different from this Vc quiescent, then this cos phi should be 0. So, that means if you want the phase to be locked at 90 degree, right, the reference input to this should be 0. So, this control voltage will get automatically adjusted as 0 when this frequency is same as this. That is what we are going to demonstrate in this frequency lock loop. If this is the same as the quiescent frequency, which is for Vc equal to 0, that means if I apply 10,000 hertz here, the phase shift should be automatically that into cos phi. Cos phi should go to 0 because this should remain 0. So, when I have not applied any frequency here, also the same thing should happen. So, it is when I am applying nothing here, nothing comes here. When I apply 10,000 hertz input, this should automatically adjust itself as 0 if it is frequency lock. That means, if thus output frequency is same as this input, the frequency error is 0, output follows the input. That is demonstrated here. I am applying the same frequency as the free running frequency, you call it 10,000 hertz, 10k, that means t equal to 0.1 millisecond. Then the phase shift between output and input gets automatically adjusted at 90 degrees. As I change the frequency of the input, the phase will change now to some other value, so that there is a finite Vc. In this case, Vc goes positive, you can see, okay. So, the frequency is higher. So, the control voltage goes positive to make the frequency of the output get locked to the same frequency as the input, but cos phi is going to be finite. That is how this whole thing is normally called as phase lock loop. This is how it works. Phase keeps on changing from the quiescent phase of 90 degree away from 90. Next one, I am going to a lower frequency, again it is log. The frequency of the output is the same as the frequency of the input. I made the purposely different in magnitude so that it is highlighted, and the control voltage goes negative, you can see. So you can see, understand this basic concept of the so called phase lock loop also very simply as a frequency follower and frequency to voltage converter. So it can be used both as frequency follower or frequency to voltage converter, which is nothing but FM detector. If the input frequency is changing, the output voltage will change according to the modulating component of the input frequency, that is FM. If it is an FSK frequency shift key, two frequencies are used. So the output which is corresponding to the input of the VCO is going to be changing at two levels, indicating the digital data of FSK. Okay, so it is an FM detector, right. VCO is an FM generator, and if VCO is put in the feedback path, it becomes an FM detector. Same thing can be extended to A to D converters and D to A converters. They are coders and decoders. Put in the feedback path, we get a voltage analog follower Vi followed by V naught. V naught is exactly equal to Vi. At this point, you can give digital input and convert it into a digital output follower. Digital input you give, digital output of this system is going to follow the digital input. You get an analog replica of the whole thing at this point. So if you put an A to D converter in the feedback path, you can make the whole thing become a D to A converter. This is how these feedback works, inversion works, right. This is also used in what is called sigma delta modulators, right. So this is the basic principle, that you use a D to A converter and A to D converter, right, in loop. Okay, this is called the sigma. Actually, if this is plus and the sign is attributed to this, then this becomes sigma delta, okay, modulator, okay, sigma delta modulator. This is A to D and this is D to A. Okay. So these are the most important applications of feedback in most of the integrated circuit systems also. At system level, we have discussed it thoroughly, and concluding, negative feedback makes the output less sensitive to insensitive to variations of parameters associated with active devices in the forward path. Negative feedback makes the output sensitive to parameter variations associated with feedback path. Positive feedback can make the output very sensitive to parameters associations associated with the loop. Encoder decoder feedback systems enable us to realize a wide range of analog signal processing functions. So this is the conclusion, that the last one was the conclusion that we made.